Good morning, Silver Creek. I'm Mackenzie Gagline and Pastor Mark's daughter, and I just wanted to welcome you here again this morning online. We are so glad you decided to join us today. Pastor Mark has a great message that he's prepared for you, and I can't wait for you to hear it. There's definitely some great information in it. Before we dive into the message today, I just want to read a quick verse with you guys. It's Revelation 4:11. It says, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive power and glory and honor, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." I hope that can just provide a little bit of hope to you this morning, and I can't wait to dive into the message. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for our time together, whether it's in person or online, Lord. I thank you for this message that Pastor Mark has prepared. I pray that your words can just spread, Lord, and may it be something that provides hope, may it be something that provides peace, and God, may we never forget how great you truly are. Amen.
Hello, Silver Creek. It is great to be with you again today and to worship the Lord with you. We will be singing "To God Be the Glory" and "God Will Make a Way," and also "Battle Hymn of the Republic." So let's worship the Lord together.
Just sort of to have some prayer time. I want to give us some different ideas and concepts of what we need to be praying for. And I just want to pray that we will have wisdom. This has been very hard for many churches to figure out when to open up their campus, when to actually invite people back on. Some churches have started it, and some have had resistance, others have had acceptance. We have chosen June 14th for our time together, and I just want us to continue to pray for wisdom in that decision. I also want us to pray just for our emotional health and our spiritual health. Loneliness is real. Depression is real. And just as many of us have fears about our physical health or with the COVID-19 scare that this pandemic has caused us. But I also believe it's equally true that we need to be praying for each other spiritually and emotionally and relationally. And so I want us to be able to pray for each other. And I want us to pray for us as a church. As we are in this transition in 2020, we need to continue to be praying for our next senior pastor. We also need to be praying that we will be a church that knows how to communicate and connect and to reach out to our community. And if you've been to some of the transitional team meetings on Zoom, you know that we are very focused on trying to reach our community for Christ. Thus, we're doing card drives and food drives. And I just want us to pray for us as a church that we will honor God and that we'll keep our commitment to Him while we learn to be missional and to move outward. And lastly, I want us to continue to pray for our giving. We want to be a generous church. We want to have a give-first mentality. And sometimes out of sight means out of mind. And many of you have been faithful to continue to give, and we thank you and we appreciate that. But we want to pray that during this time of the pandemic and this time of transition, that we can be united in our generosity and have a give-first mentality. So what I'd like for us to do is maybe just pause the video and for us to pray. And I'm also going to pray for us. It's not going to be a long prayer. It's going to be a simple, straightforward prayer. But I'd like to pray for us today. So please join me in prayer. And again, hopefully either before this or after this, you'll take some time to pray, either as an individual or as a couple or as a family. So let us pray. Father, many of us have been humbled. Many of us maybe have been discouraged. Some of us have actually found new hope and new strength and new perspective during our time away. But I pray, dear Lord, that our hearts will be responsive to love you with all of our heart, soul, strength, and mind, and that we will love our neighbor as ourselves. I pray, dear Lord, that we will remain physically healthy, but beyond that, we want to be spiritually and relationally healthy and alive. And so I pray, dear Lord, for our emotions, our heart, our mind, our thoughts, our behavior, our attitudes, our actions. Allow us, dear Lord, to not be conformed to the world, but allow us to be transformed by the renewing of our mind. I pray, dear Lord, you continue to give our church and other churches wisdom as we move forward. I pray, dear Lord, for our church. I pray, dear Lord, that we will remain true and faithful to give first to God, and so that we can continue to be generous and give to our community and to our missionaries and to the mission field and to the new challenges we're going to have as we open up our doors. And so I just pray, dear Lord, that we will be faithful to give. And I pray, dear Lord, as we give, that all of us will say a prayer and ask that We will trust you with our finances, but that we will use these finances to make a difference in our community. Give us wisdom as a church about our future. And I pray, dear Lord, for the person that is going to come here and to serve as a settled pastor. I pray, dear Lord, that you will give that person, just prepare their heart, prepare their mind, and may we get our hearts and our minds ready to welcome and to receive our new pastor. So we give you the rest of this service, we give you the rest of this day, we give you this weekend. And as we remember those who have served our country and have given up their lives for our country, we just want to say thank you, but we want to honor and show our respect. We thank you for our country. Give our president, give our nation's leaders, give our governor, give our commissioners and the Board of Public Health and the CDC. Give everybody wisdom and discernment how we can move forward. In Jesus' name, amen.
Singing for us. Join me as I read today's scripture from Revelation 3, 1 through 6. To the angel of the church in Sardis write, "These are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up, strengthen what remains and is about to die. For I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. Remember therefore what you have received and heard. Obey it and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me, dressed in white, for they are worthy. He who overcomes will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out his name from the book of life, but will acknowledge his name before my Father and his angels. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." May the Lord bless the reading of his scripture today. Join us as we continue to worship.
Loose the fateful lightning of his terrible.
continue our series called The Overcomers as we continue to look at the seven churches in Revelation. And I have to say, I'm really excited about today's message because even though I've enjoyed looking at the previous four churches that we've looked at, I'm really excited about this message today because I think it's so practical, so real, and something that will be helpful for you in your Christian life, but it's going to be helpful for us as a church. And I just want to start with a question. Are you a starter or are you a finisher? Are you known? Do you have a reputation that you can get a lot of things going and start this project, or as a church, we start this ministry, or we have this vision, we have this idea, we have this dream, but when it's all said and done, it never happens. We never finish. And I have seen this over the course of my life being a teacher. I've taught people about their spiritual gifts and they get really excited, but then when it comes to finishing and actually applying their spiritual gifts, it never happens. Or I remember speaking at camp, and maybe you've had this experience with yourself or your son or daughter. They go off to camp, they come back, and they're so excited about God, what God is teaching them, but then in a matter of a week or two, all is forgotten. And there's no finishing. And we know that Jesus had challenged us that as his disciples, it's far worse to say, yes, we're going to follow Jesus, and then to stop following Jesus. Jesus, and then Paul later remind us that we need to finish well, or we need to finish strong. And that's what we're going to talk today about, is finishing strong. And I don't know how you answered whether you're a starter or a finisher, but this is the other picture I want us to start with this morning, is I want us to look into the mirror. When is the last time, spiritually speaking, you have looked into the mirror and you've looked at your life and you've actually pondered the question, how am I doing? You know, every church needs to ask that question. Every church needs to ask, what's working? What's not working? We just, in our transition team meeting last time, we talked about our strengths, where we're strong, where we're weak, what are the opportunities before us, and what are the threats. Not only does a church and an organization need to ask that question about their strengths and weaknesses and opportunities and threats, but we as Christ followers, we should be very discerning and judgmental of our own lives, and we should be looking in the mirror and we should be saying, God, what do you want to change? Just like you look in the mirror and you say, oh, my hair's a mess, or I got something in my teeth, or my skin, something looks wrong there. It's too red, or there's bumps there, or maybe back in the days there's a zit there, and just trying to figure it all out, and there's something needs to change. We need to make our appearance reflective of who we are. And so today we want to pause as we look at the church at Sardis, and we want to evaluate, because as we've been looking at these four churches so far, we're in our fifth church, but in all four of the churches, Christ is walking through the church. So just sort of like me today, even though the sanctuary is empty, I'm here in the sanctuary, and Christ, when we're gathered together, Christ is walking through our church, and he's observing. And he's not just observing at our church building, he's observing us as his church, his body, as we go into our neighborhoods and we go into our community and we go back into our homes and we go to work. When we go to have fun and go to the park, and shortly as we go to the lake, and eventually maybe when we start eating out again and we start going to concerts or ball games, Christ is evaluating us. He's walking among us. And so just by way of review, when Christ walked through the church in Ephesus, the main idea was we need to love first. We need to love God and we need to love others. And that needs to be something that we put as a priority. We need to love first. Now, the church in Smyrna was, we needed to stay true. In the face of suffering and persecution and difficulties and setbacks, we as a church and we as Christ followers, we need to stay true. The church in Pergamum, they had to expose error. And just like in our culture today, there's many false teachings and false narratives. We even talk about it in the news. There's fake news. And we need to, as Christ followers, we need to expose error. And we need to proclaim the truth of God. The church in Thyatira, we looked at last week, needed to continue to pursue purity. Or they needed to hold on to holiness. They needed to remain true and not engage in the world's practice of, for them, it was sexual immorality and it was idolatry and food sacrifice to idols. They needed to stay pure and pursue purity. And for all of these churches, as Christ walked among them and he gave them a challenge, he also promised them a reward. And to the one who overcomes, he promises some special recognition or some special reward for their ability to overcome. So today with the church in Sardis, and if you haven't opened up your Bibles yet to Revelation 3, I would encourage you to do that. They need to finish strong. In fact, can you say that with me? Finish strong. I know it may sound weird, but to say it by yourself or in your living room, finish strong. And maybe you need to look at your spouse or your children and you need to ask, am I a finisher? And then you need to encourage that person and say, finish strong. So just like in every church, there's a description about the character of Christ. And I don't want to spend too much time on this, but notice what it says in verse 1. He says, the words of Jesus Christ, and it says, he has the seven spirits and the seven stars. The image is he has them in his hands. Seven represents wholeness or perfection or completeness. Seven is sort of the perfect number. And so the spirits, earlier in Revelation, the seven spirits represent those who are lead angels. And as I've talked about, the stars represent the lead pastors, probably. And so Christ is saying, I'm in spiritual authority in the heavenly realms, but I'm also in control, and I have the whole council before me of the churches here on earth. That is the character of Christ, which gives him the ability to judge and to observe and to evaluate. Now notice here the commendation of Christ. In all the churches, except a couple of them, there really isn't a condemnation or a commendation or a word of praise. And this one is sort of interesting. He says, I know your works. If I could take a time out here, this is so important for us as Christ followers. It's so important for us as a church. And earlier, he talked about churches and he would say, I know your works. And he would explain in great detail either their faith or their perseverance or their character. But here, Christ just says, I know your works. And it's almost like a parent saying, yeah, I see what you're doing. It doesn't comment anymore because they don't want to be too harsh or difficult. But Christ is saying, I know your works. I've observed. And we need to stop kidding ourselves. Christ is always observing us. And he knows. He knows what we're thinking. He knows what we're saying. He knows what we're hearing and seeing. We talked about that last week. Christ knows what is happening, but specifically, he knows our works. He knows our deeds, whether they're good or whether they're bad, whether they're holy or unholy, whether they're just or unjust. Christ knows our works. And that should cause all of us to walk with humility and grace, knowing that Christ knows. Back in the day, there was a football player, baseball player. Some thought he was the greatest athlete of the time until he had a knee injury, but his name was Bo Jackson. And there was always a commercial on, and it was on quite regularly, and it said, Bo knows, Bo knows, Bo knows. What John wants us to know is Christ knows. Jesus knows. The Holy Spirit knows. Which should cause us all to be real and to be authentic. But notice this word of commendation is really none at all. He says, I know your works. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. This is so true today. It's true of churches. Churches have a reputation sometimes of being alive, either because, like our church, they've existed for a very long time, or they've supported missions, or they've supported missionaries, or maybe they had a famous pastor, or maybe they have a nice sanctuary, or they have a nice location. And people say, hey, that church, it's on the move. It's existed for a while. I've heard of that church. It's easy, too, as a Christ follower. You know, somebody says, oh, yeah, I know that person goes to church. Or they see you at work, or they see you, again, when we're playing sports. Oh, yeah, that person's a Christian. And maybe there's just a reputation there, but deep down inside, there's nothing to show for it. It's a false reputation. And that's sort of where we get the word hypocrisy. When somebody pretends to be something that they're not, trying to get a reputation. But notice this condemnation of the church in verse 2. He has harsh words. He says, wake up and strengthen what remains and is about to die. For I have not found your works complete in the sight of my God. He's saying, wake up! Wake up. The time is now to change. We need to wake up and realize that we are spiritually incomplete. You see, this church at Sardis is very similar to the culture of the city. The culture of the city, they did not know how to finish strong. They thought they were a military power, but then they fizzled out. They thought they were leading. We looked at it last week, even with the other church in Thyatira, that they had a reputation for textiles and dye and sort of was a factory town. This town, Sardis, started off rich, but then they lost everything. It's sort of like a famous ball player that makes millions of dollars, and then you read about them in a few years after they've retired, and they say that they're bankrupt. The city was not a finisher, and probably the key was they had started to build a temple because they wanted to be like Ephesus, and they wanted a temple like the Temple of Diana. And so they started their temple, but they didn't finish. But the problem was the church was just the same. They started off alive, but now they had fallen asleep. And again, as I continue to get to know us, and it's been hard because of this isolation, and I haven't gotten to know us well, but I think you just need to ask the question as a church, have we fallen asleep? As a church, is there no life anymore? Is there no fruit? Is there no conversions? Is there no baptisms? Is there nobody hungry and thirsty to come to church? Is there's no process for making disciples and followers of Christ? And as individuals, if you're watching me as an individual today, is there no fruit in your life? Did you make a commitment at one time to follow Christ? Was it something that happened at camp long ago? Was it something that happened as a child in Sunday school? Is it something that happened at church long ago when you came forward at an altar? Is it something that really never ever developed? And there comes a warning in this commendation. It says you are spiritually dead. You have failed to finish. And you need to wake up. Notice what it says in verse 3. It says, remember then what you have received and heard. Keep it and repent. Once again, there's this concept of repentance. And again, every Sunday, I think I turn around. Repentance means to change your ways, to change the direction, to change your course of your life, change your mind, change your thoughts, behaviors, your actions, your emotions, your relationships. Get your relationship right with God. But before repentance comes this word, remember. He emphasizes it. It was interesting last week on Tuesday night's Bible study in the book of Ephesians, which again, I would encourage you to come and get into the Word of God. We looked at this word, remember. The Gentiles were to remember how they at one time didn't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. The Apostle John, which is giving Christ words, Christ is saying, remember. Remember when you made that commitment? Remember when you said, I will follow you, Lord, wherever you go? Remember when you said, I love you, God. Thank you for saving me. I love you, God. Thank you for forgiving me of my sins. Thank you, God, for speaking to me through the Word of God. And as a church, maybe you're saying, God, thank you for all the many celebrations we had, or the opportunities we've had for outreach, or the opportunities we've had to support missions, or we thank you for the pastors we've had. We thank you for our past. We thank you for our rich history. But now nothing is happening. And Jesus Christ is saying, remember. Remember it fondly so that you will repent, so that you'll be hungry and thirsty to come back. So here's the challenge of Christ. Notice what he's saying. He's saying, wake up. And then he says, if you will not wake up, if you will not wake up, if you stay asleep. Have you ever taken a nap at an odd time and you're really tired and you're trying to get up, but you can't get up and somebody's trying to wake you up and you just really are like real groggy and you can't get the energy going? Well, many of us are like that spiritually. And we just can't wake up. And Jesus Christ says, you need to wake up. And you need to strengthen what still remains. It's saying, take what has been happening in your life spiritually, whether if you have to go all the way back to I'm saved by grace and that God's mercies are new every day, and that you got to go back to your core identity, that in Christ Jesus there is hope, in Christ Jesus there is redemption, in Christ Jesus there is a way, in Christ Jesus there is a truth, in Christ Jesus there is life. And I want to get back to my beginning steps, and I want to walk with Christ and get in the Word and follow the Holy Spirit. And he's saying, if you wake up and you strengthen what is remained, your Holy Spirit inside of you will come alive. And you will start being Spirit-empowered and Spirit-led and Spirit-filled. And God's Spirit will work in you, producing the fruit of the Spirit, which is love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and self-control. Now notice this. He says, there's still a few people that remain. And I would say that's true in our church and in every church. Sometimes it gets down to a very small core. A very small core. And he says, for you still in that core who have not soiled yourself and you gotten your clothes dirty, for those few of you who have remained pure and on the straight and narrow and haven't been playing games with God and haven't been pretending, you've stayed in the Word of God, you've stayed true to the commission to go and make disciples of all nations, you've remained true to following Christ and loving your spouse and bringing your children up in the discipline of the Lord and sharing your faith at work or sharing your faith in the community. You've remained true to what God is calling you to do. Jesus Christ is there. Just like in Hebrews chapter 12, a great cloud of witnesses, and they're just standing there and they're applauding you and they're saying, keep going. And I want to say, from what I've noticed, sometimes it feels like there's just a few people at Silver Creek Church of God who really want us to go forward and to make a difference and to reach our community. And not only am I saying, let's go forward, but Jesus Christ is clapping and he's saying, go forward, go for it, remain true. And then there is this promise. It says, to the one who conquers or the one who overcomes. He says, you will be clothed in white garments. There's going to be holiness. There's going to be purity. And he also says that he will walk with them. You're going to, if you remain true, and you finish strong, guess what? You're going to have a sweet fellowship with Jesus Christ. A sweet fellowship with Jesus Christ here, but also a sweet fellowship with Christ in the future. And he'll feel close and near and present in your life. And you will talk with him and he will talk with you. He'll lead you. He'll guide you. He'll direct you. And this is true both individually and as a church. But notice this promise. And I just need to say it because so many people are confused when they hear these words where he says, I will never blot his name out of the book of life. In the Greek, the emphasis is even stronger. He says, I will never, ever, 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 ever blot your name out of the book of life. The book of life holds the names of those who will spend an eternity with their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. They'll spend the eternity with those who have placed their faith in Jesus Christ. They'll spend eternity with those who have been forgiven. They'll spend eternity with their brothers and sisters in the Lord. And the way he makes this promise has confused some people because they failed to understand that this is a figure of speech and it's used for emphasis. And so he's using a negative to reassure a positive. And it's not like, oh, if I don't finish strong, my name's going to be ripped out of the book of life. No, that's not true. Because our faith is secure because we are saved by faith through grace in Jesus Christ alone. And there's nothing we can do to add to that. So no one can boast. Our salvation is free. Because it cost Jesus Christ his death and his life on our behalf. And Jesus Christ rose again so that we might have life and life more abundantly. So why is he even saying, I'll never, ever, ever blot your name out of the book of life? Because he wants to give us the assurance that we will, if we overcome and we finish strong, we can have a blessed assurance that Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. So what is our next steps as a church and as Christ followers? My message is we need to finish strong. So one church, it was to love first. To another church, it was to stay true. To another church, it was to expose error. To another church, it was pursue purity. And today's message is finish strong. And you finish strong by following Christ faithfully. Get into the Word of God. And for us as a church, it means we stay true to the promises of God. And as a church, we stay true to the mission of the church, which is to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. and we remain true and we finish strong and we love God and we love one another just as Christ has loved us. We don't want to be a church that doesn't finish. We don't want to be a Christ follower that doesn't finish. May we finish strong for the glory of God. I'd like to close with a benediction. And today I'd like to close with the benediction from Romans 15, 13. So may now the God of hope fill you with joy and peace as you trust in him, so that your hearts may overflow with hope through the Holy Spirit. God bless you. Have a great weekend. Hopefully you get out and spend some time with family and friends. But most of all, have a safe Memorial Day weekend and continue to pray for us as we try to get back together as soon as possible. God bless you and have a great rest of the day.